So this is the sixth stage. Any questions about this? The symptoms, the mood, the stage, anything, how the stage develops. And then I don't have too much to say on this. I could read some of my notes. One is free to cultivate pure spiritual emotions. One's mind are automatically under the influence of Krishna's Swarup Shakti energy. Rupa Goswami compares Bhava to a ray of sunlight and Prema to the sun itself. Bhava Bhakti is distinct from Prema and Sarva Bhakti, but contains elements of both. It's like on the leaving Sarva Bhakti and moving into Prema Bhakti, it has the symptoms of both Prema Bhakti and Sarva Bhakti. By cultivating the various ingredients of aesthetic rapture and by identifying with a particular role model in Krishna Lila from the vantage point of one's inner spiritual identity, in other words, one aspires or has already aspired in the previous stage of Ruchi to follow an eternal associate of the Lord in Sri Vrindavan. What does that mean? There's two things, Anuskaran and Anusharan. Anusharan means to follow in the footsteps. Anuskaran means to imitate. Imitation is cheap. Imitation is, what we say, unreal. One cannot imitate the activities of good souls. When people try to do that in order to somehow show some symptoms of advancement, or just I want to be like them, so I imitate what they do. No, this is not Vaishnava. Vaishnava hears about the persons they are aspiring to follow, glorifies them, chants their names, their glories, prays to them, and worships them in various ways. And that way, that eternal associate will help to direct that person to higher levels of spiritual understanding. And if that person is not in the mood of your eternal swarup, that person will bring you to where you actually are. Because they actually know who you are spiritually. So this is mentioned that one should adopt an eternal associate of the Lord and hear about that and glorify that and pray for that so they can help one. Assist one in coming to one's professional stage. This is required, it's not optional. If we don't do this on the higher stages, then we're missing something in the practice. We need a help of an eternal associate. We can adopt one of the, just like Tulsi. Tulsi Devi is an eternal associate of the Lord in Sri Vrindavan. And we pray Tulsi Devi to bring us to Sri. We actually sing, when we sing the Tulsi song, we're actually praying, my dear Lord, bring me to Sri Vrindavan. And the translation, it mentions that. You are a resident of Sri Vrindavan. Prabhupada established Tulsi Devi is one of the highest forms of worship in Vaishnava culture. We just kind of like, there's Tulsi, you offer three drops, they go around, what's next? She's an eternal son. She's manifested her mercy by appearing in the form of a Tulsi tree. But she's actually Vrindadevi, who makes all the arrangements, or assists Purnamasi, who is Rodamaya in the spiritual world, assisting Purnamasi and making all arrangements for Radha and Krishna to come together around this place. She's a very elevated personality. She's come in the form of this Tulsi tree. So when you read those prayers to Tulsi Devi, they're not small. In fact, Prabhupada was challenged by some other Vaishnavas and even one of his grandbrothers. How can you give this to the Westerners? This is so high. They'll never understand this. No one will ever develop the qualifications to worship Tulsi properly. But Prabhupada, in the mood of giving Mahaprabhu's mission, adopted certain things that were quite elevated, and at the same time teaching us how to approach these things in the popular way. But understanding that where we are and what we're worshiping is a quite a different level of understanding and practice. So she's one of the eternal associates one can pray to, and of course one can adopt the residence of Vrindavan, Dhamma Maharaj, Subal, or one of the gopis, to pray, to assist in our, what we say, development of higher levels of bhakti. This is required on these stages. Any comments or questions about Bhagavad Bhakti? It's a very difficult subject, I know. Just for me to give this class, so to keep moving. Yes, Adelana?
Can you ask, what
means Ashyabandha? Ashyabandha? It means great hope.
Great hope.
Not hope, but great hope. I will achieve love of God. And I'm willing to do whatever it takes to achieve love of God. That's on the lower stages. On the higher stages, one is actually experiencing it. Great hope. Sometimes we call it hope against hope. There's really no hope, but still let me hope anyway. But higher than hope against hope is complete hopelessness. So when you reach the stage of complete hopelessness, you have reached the stage of a proper mood of your expression of loving sentiment. There's no hope that I'll ever make it. But in that no hope, somehow or other, you become qualified to receive the ultimate perfection. Because if you think you can do it, then that's a disqualification. So hoping that you'll do it is acceptable, but hoping, knowing that there's no hope, is even better. But higher than that, it's hopelessness. So you can choose which level. It's hopeless. How will I ever? But I know your mercy is great. You show your mercy to even the most fallen conditioned souls in this world, Jagais and Marai. So I do have hope. But actually, when I look at myself, there's no hope. Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami were condemning themselves in front of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. We are so fallen. Jagai and Manai never took up service to the Islamic government. Look, we did. We gave up our caste. We gave up everything just to serve these low-class people. They did it for a reason, to protect the Brahminical community from being tortured by the Nala. But at the same time, I know when they did that, they were expressing how fallen they were for doing that. And so in that expression of fallenness, they were saying, Jagai and Madai, they're much better than we are. They never took up the service of these malicious. We have done that. So they were expressing that to Lord Chaitanya. Lord Chaitanya was seeing their natural humanity. But that's how they were feeling. You see, when we read the prayers of the great souls, and they talk, it's like, what is that prayer? It's a bhajan by Bhakti Vinod Thakur. Sare pape mate. What is the first word?
Amara
jivan. Sare pape rati. Nahiya puyero esa. He's saying, Sada Pape Rate. I am so sinful. Pape means sinful. Sada means always sinful. I'm always sinful. There's no hope for me. He's sinful like that. Bhakti Vinod Thakur, a person we take instructions and guidance from. And why is he singing like that? So he would be known as a humble devotee? No, he's feeling like that. These are the feelings of persons who are on a higher platform. The understanding is the more a person progresses in the process of their devotional service, the more they feel unqualified, low, wretched, sinful, and what we say, just useless. When we first joined the Hare Krishna movement, let me see, it'll take me maybe a few more months and I'll be able to do it. We used to call it PDS, Pure Devotee Syndrome. He said he joins the movement, he's doing all kinds, he's chanting his rounds very seriously in the morning, he's doing all kinds of service, he dances in the kirtans, he's eating nice, he's having a, gee, I got the process down. I must be a pure devotee. Maybe if I haven't made it yet, it'll be very soon. But, you know, as you make advancement in Krishna consciousness, you start to understand that, you know, I'm so fallen. It's like, we call it like, ever try to wash coal, you know, a piece of coal? And you say, I'm going to clean coal. So the more you scrub the coal, what happens? It just exudes more darkness and dirt. So a devotee feels like that. My heart is so dirty. And the more I chant the Hare Krishna, the more I can just see how fallen I am. So we get the examples from Bhaktivinoda Thakur, from Rupa Goswami, and all the great souls, they just think they're the lowest of the low. Although they're on the highest spiritual pathway. So these are symptoms of advancement. And the devotee feels very, very humble. They feel completely useless. They give respects to everyone and never consider themselves even noticeable. Honestly. Yeah. Sanatana Goswami, he didn't even want to walk past the Jagannath Puri temple because he was afraid that if when the pujaris would come back and forth, they would see him. And he felt so contaminated, it would spoil their day if they saw him. That's how he was feeling. So in order to see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he wanted to see Mahaprabhu. He took another route, and he didn't go past the Jagannath temple. He came by the way of the beach. And this was in the month of Jaist. Now Jaist is the month of July, and the sands were hot and burning. When he got there, he offered his obeisances. Lord Chaitanya noticed his feet. He said, your feet are all burnt and are full of blisters. Which way did you come? And he said, my dear Lord, I came by way of the beach. He said, why didn't you go past the Jagannath temple? And Sanatana Goswami was feeling, he didn't even want to explain why he did it. He said, my dear Lord, I'm so contaminated. I didn't want to contaminate the pujaris. That's how he was feeling. Lord Chaitanya glorified humility of Sanatana Goswami. He says, Sanatana Goswami, there is no one who exhibits humility on a level with you. And Lord Chaitanya actually said that. One can never understand the humility of Sanatana Goswami. So and here, he's so elevated. And it's amazing, we were speaking about this yesterday, that pride has a tendency to enter into a person who has some qualities. You see that in material life quite often. The more qualified you person are, the more proud they become of their qualities or their activities. So when you have very little, you might say humility is a little bit more easier to, you know, to acquiesce, to bring about. But when you learn, when you have a lot, you know, you might be noticed as a great ability and has so many good qualities. But still, humility is there. How glorious that is. How glorious that is. So the persons on this platform are exhibiting great amounts of humility because they're feeling the presence of Krishna. They're actually experiencing Krishna within their own heart. And sometimes Krishna leaves and then they feel unhappy. Then Krishna comes back and they feel happy. So their emotions are being drawn from side to side by Krishna's apparent disappearance and appearance within their consciousness. Any other questions? Yes?
Can you answer this jump of relation to wasting time?
Strong aversion to wasting time.
You should be practicing fine meditation compassion. If you see this, that you're wasting time.
These symptoms of compassion, tolerance.
Yeah, we should be practicing these things, all these qualities. And if you witness someone wasting time.
Wasting time.
Like you mentioned, probably get really angry.
If somebody was wasting his time, he would become upset. And he also preached to us not to waste time.
And this could lead you in a situation
where... When you see someone wasting time,
yeah.
Tell them don't waste time. Chant Hare Krishna. You can always chant Hare Krishna, even if you have apparently nothing to do. The holy name is always available. Just chant, then you're not wasting time. At any time you can just chant. Always. Prabhupada did a dramatic expression in one class. He stopped the class, it was a Bhagavatam class in the morning. He said, it's now 7:35. He says, now it's 7:36. 7:35 on December 23rd, 1974 is no longer here. It is gone. You can't buy it back. You may be a Kurapati. You may be a millionaire. You can't buy that moment back. How valuable time is. Bhakti Siddhanta also says, money has value, but time is precious. Time is precious. Money, you can get it, and you can lose it, and you can regain it. But time goes in one direction. So, and there's many, many verses in the Bhagavatam that illustrates the importance of using every moment in the best possible way. That's the word. Kala chakra? Yeah.
Maharaj, how does conviction fit in this intense hopelessness? The one side we are hopeless, the other side we also have the conviction of bhakti. Otherwise, the hopelessness leads into remorse and...
No, the hopelessness doesn't create inertia or stagnation. It's hopeless, but your mercy is great. He still is hopeless. It's understanding the mood. When you look at yourself, it's hopeless. When you look at Krishna's mercy, it becomes successful. And that's how they look at it. They look at it. When we look at ourselves, we say it's hopeless. There's no chance. But then we look at Krishna's mercy, and we see how his mercy is given great to others, and very full, and then we think there's hope. So it's a constant move and swaying of the different ways. Another question? There was a hand up here. Yes, another?
Sometimes you see that the devotees, they are gentle, they get emotional, they start crying. Is this like shadow or reflection of this?
Well, it depends. It could be real, it could be, shadow. It doesn't mean because you're a new devotee you can't express emotions on the higher part. It says that the holy name of the Lord can give ecstasy even to a neophyte if their consciousness is in the right mood. In other words, if they're completely receptive, their hearts are open, their minds are receptive to the holy name, they can experience ecstasy. Even a brand new, even non-devotees. That's the power though. But it's not consistent. So when we speak about new persons, yeah, it's possible. But then again, we instruct that one should not try to, you know, allow these things to manifest. When you feel them coming, you should try to check them. Everything's done as a service, it's fine. But when it's done just for some, you know, egoistic expression, no. Raising your hands in the air during kirtan is a sign of surrender. It's a sign of glorification, it's a sign of surrender. It's recommended we do that. By performing these activities according to the acharya's directions, it helps to develop that proper mood in kirtan. So if you're standing in kirtan and you're thinking, I'll wait till the ecstasy comes, it'll never come. You have to sing, you have to dance, you have to raise your arms. You have to get into the kirtan just as a service. And as you do that, then Krishna says, oh, okay. They're into it. And then you start to feel. So if you wait for the feelings to come first, they may, but that's not the proper mood. The proper mood is to sing with enthusiasm, dance. Prabhupada said you should dance like, what is it called, a swami step? He showed us how to dance, the swami step. He said, raise your arms. Okay? You should be done. And you're there still. When's that ecstasy coming? I can see the other one he's having. Maybe we'll come to this section of the room sooner or later. No, you gotta get into it. It's like doing a service. Just like when you do a service, you have to act. So the same way in kirtan, you have to. I mean, if you're there and you're absorbing the holy name and you're just hearing the holy name, what that does is help you to inspire to get to sing and to dance. But if you never come to that stage in the kirtan, you're not in kirtan. You're not there. You haven't really, you're not personalized and fully, you're not personal in the kirtan. Say it here, you want to say it in Croatian, and everybody's going to translate it.
If we cry, how we can recognize that it's not only the sentiment, this is
for someone else or for yourself? For yourself or for someone else?
For someone else.
Don't worry about it. If someone else is doing it, it could be real, it may not be. But the question was also mentioned here, and under Vargas asked the same question. It may be real. Maybe actually it's feelings of emotion that arise. There's different, in the Shastras it says there's different characteristics about Krishna that invokes his emotional feelings. His flute, the way he stands, his dress, his smile, his what else? Bugle horn. Different qualities in the paraphernalia of Krishna can cause a person to feel ecstasy. And just the singing itself, when it's done so nicely, the devotees are singing nicely, a person whose heart is open, that means they're just absorbing everything. They may experience tears. But Prabhupada told us to try to check it. And not, but sometimes you can check it. It happens. But you really can't tell from another person on what's happening to another person. Unless you're really on a high level. Then you can see. Prabhupada could see what was real and what was not real. When the devotee, when that person came in to see Prabhupada, the devotees were actually thinking this person was in ecstasy, but Prabhupada could see it wasn't. And you really can't tell. That's not so important. If I see somebody crying during the cure time, I just say, that's different. And I just divert my attention away from that. I don't focus on anybody else's ecstasy. I don't think it's a thing we should do. Yes, any other questions? What else?
I would like to ask regarding the topic of wasting time. Because sometimes I feel like we are always in a big rush to our service, and somehow it's because of this, our relationship with devotees are yours.
It's not an external feature, it's a consciousness. The consciousness is, I'm using every moment in Krishna's service. Whether you are running 90 miles an hour or 5 miles an hour, that's not the point. The point is how you're using your time. Yeah? It's not like we, by going faster, we're saving time. Maybe, maybe not, but we might be causing more problems and then making mistakes, and that wastes his time. Sometimes when you rush, you make a mistake, and it throws you back in time. You have to fix the mess you made. So a devotee is conscious and cautious. Conscious of Krishna and cautious to act in the proper way, so as not to do things impetuously or more, how would we say, mindlessly. So, not wasting time means focusing, that's all. Okay, does that help? Any questions on the men's side? Yes?
What is Krishna experiencing when one has these symptoms?
What is Krishna experiencing when we have these symptoms? What is he experiencing? Well, I think Prabhupada would say, why don't you ask him? Prabhupada told us when he, kind of, he answered that a question like that many times. He should be experiencing so many things like that. You're asking because you think I know what Krishna's experience is. I haven't reached that level. I can ask him. Whether he answers me or not is another thing, and whether I can hear his answer or not is another thing. Yeah.
In the next devotion, it's explained that it's an offense to cry in front of the deity. So if someone starts crying, should
we
just leave the deity, leave the temple?
One should do that. Yeah, one should, when they feel that emotion, they should remove themselves and try to hide that, or stop it. Yeah.
So if someone's very advanced, maybe they can't even enter the temple?
It happens. It happens. If somebody's crying, don't push him out the door. I wouldn't recommend that. Because they might be experiencing multi-ecstasies, and one of them is anger. So you might get it. It's like, what is it? In the kirtan in Jagannath Puri, when Srivasta Thakur was watching Chaitanya Mahaprabhu dance, and Bharata Purudu was there, and there was another Krishna, his name was Sudananda, I can't remember his name. So Srivasta Thakur was in ecstasy watching Lord Chaitanya dancing. And this other person couldn't see, so he tried to push Srivasta Thakur out of the way so he could see. So Srivasta Thakur turned around and slapped him in ecstasy. And then that person started to get upset. King Prabhupada Puruja says, "You don't realize how fortunate you are to get slapped by Srivasta Thakur." So consider it a benediction. I don't recommend pushing people out. I don't know what kind of ecstasy you might exhibit. But you're right. To answer the question, you're right. A person who's experiencing that emotion should not stay in front of the viewers, as mentioned in the next video. Because it looks like you're trying to attract attention, although it might be real. And others will misunderstand, that's the point. Others will either criticize, misunderstand, or falsely praise. So that's the idea. Yes, Radhacharan.
Thank you, Maharaj. If somebody has no control over crying or shedding tears in front of the deity, is this person a lost cause?
A lost cause? I think he's in contact with the cause of all causes. I don't think he's lost cause, no. Uncontrollably? We don't, recommend you do that. The person should check that. They should try to check that. Prabhupada would check his own ecstasy. Sometimes he couldn't because the force of the ecstasy was too strong. But many times we saw Prabhupada about to exhibit some ecstatic emotion and restrain it.
But if you have no control at all, how do you check?
If it's happening and you don't have any control, you should ask someone else to control it for you. I don't know if I can give a good practical answer to that. It's just sometimes that happens.
Could it be the ultimate integrity?
The thing is to hide it. If you're crying, just, cover your face so nobody sees it. Including Krishna. Hide it. And we don't want to make a show. It's not a show, it's real, but it's for others. I never understand. So it's not done in public. You just try to understand that. I mean, you go to some temples in India and there's people rolling on the ground and exhibiting all kinds of things. So this is done pretentiously. And Prabhupada never liked that. Bhakti Siddhanta was very strong about that. So even if it's real, a person should take some precautions to check it. That's recommended. Yes, Michelle?
Is Prema Bhakti and Bhava Bhakti the same, or is it
different? Prema Bhakti and Bhava Bhakti the same? Bhava Bhakti is like a plant that's flowering, and Prema Bhakti is like a fully blown flower plant. So the intensity. So we read here, Prema Bhava Bhakti is like a ray of the sun, and Prema Bhakti is like the sun. So we don't have much time, so the seventh verse and the eighth verse, which is the last two verses, deal with very high symptoms of ecstasy. Usually these two verses pertain to Srimati Radharani, and Lord Chaitanya in the ecstasy of Radharani speaks these two verses. So maybe we can just chant these verses. Does everyone remember them? What is the first word of the seventh
verse?
Yugaitam Yishinam Chakshushanaprasashayitam Shunayitam Jagatsarvam Govindavirayamane. O Govinda, feeling your separation and considering a moment to be 12 years or more, tears are falling from my eyes like torrents of rain, and I'm feeling all vacant in your absence. Aslishyavadhirtam pranastamam adarshanam marahatam karotuva yatadatavadhirtatulam prato matpranyasasasenanapara. What's the first word of the translation?
I don't know one
but Krishna is my Lord, and he shall remain so even if he handles me roughly by his embrace, makes me brokenhearted by the not present before me. He's completely free to do anything and everything because he's my worshipful Lord unconditionally. So these two verses are Prema Bhakti, but they're different. One is Prema in separation, one is Prema in meeting. The first one is Prema in separation, which is called Vipralama Bhav. The second one is Prema in meeting, which is called Sambhoga. So these two, Lord Chaitanya is exhibiting his loving emotions in the mood of Srimati Radharani for Krishna. That a moment seems like 12 years. Feeling your separation is like the moment lasts forever. We see that. Time is relative. If you're happy, what is time like? How would you describe time when you're happy?
Short. Very fast.
Fast. When you're happy, time goes fast. When you're sad, time is like
forever.
Slow. But when you are waiting, how fast does time go? Doesn't move. The clock stops. Yeah. So time is relative to your consciousness. And when you're in love, time is eternal. So therefore Lord Chaitanya is showing that one moment in separation from you is so painful, it's like 12 years from now. Therefore I'm feeling unhappy. The mood of loving relationship with Krishna and the mood of separation, longing for that union, causes the heart to be intensified so much that one is actually feeling the presence in the mood of absence. When Krishna left Vrindavan, he told the gopis, I'm never separate, I'm always there in your heart, just think of me. And he was actually telling the truth but at the same time they wanted Krishna's personal presence. They could feel Krishna in their heart, and in that heartfelt presence, but at the same time, they were exhibiting that same mood that Lord Chaitanya was talking. They felt separation, although they were meeting Krishna in their heart. So the longing for Krishna, the mood of separation, is a form of meeting Krishna within the heart. And when meeting comes after longing, how much more wonderful the meeting is. Just like we see that in ordinary, just like I travel in airports. And sometimes you see people meeting their friends and relatives and they get off the plane. such excitement to see each other. You know, they embraced and laughing. And then after a few seconds, it's different. You know, it's just the initial meeting after the separation brings such happiness because there's a longing to meet. And thinking about the person and thinking about the times we had together increases that longing. And then when that meeting comes, the ecstasy is even higher. But therefore, when you're always with a person, you don't really appreciate as much as when you are not with them and then with them again. This is good marital counseling. You want to keep the relationship together. It's nice to have a little separation. Keep the flavor going. Not too bold. I didn't know that it seemed like nobody agreed with me. Because I don't have any practical experience. But anyway, this is what I understand. Yeah, so separation increases meeting. Now the last verse is meeting. My dear Lord, she calls Krishna a dibhansh. What is the word in that word?
Lampito.
Here a dibhansh. This is Radharani's mood. She's calling Krishna. What is that dibhansh? That your activities are so unpredictable. Sometimes you're here and sometimes you're not here. But it doesn't matter. I still love you. You can break my heart, it doesn't matter. It doesn't change my love for you. You can leave me, it doesn't matter. I will never give up my loving relationship. So this is the highest form of love. Even when the apparent partner doesn't reciprocate, but the love remains strong and ever-increasing, this is the highest form of love. Love for the sake of love and not for the sake of reciprocation. But once reciprocation is there, of course, the sweetness is intensified. But even in that lack of reciprocation, the love is not disturbed. So this is the final expression of loving sentiments in the Bhakti path, this last verse. So generally we say these higher moods are for the gopis and for the Radharani. Very rare to see that in this world. So this is what Lord Chaitanya gave us in these eight prayers, the complete science of loving devotion to Krishna, from the beginning stages of substrata, all the way up to the highest stage of loving emotions from Krishna and then moving through Vrindavan. Any more comments or questions? Yes, Bhakti Gamya.
When reciting the Shikshastakam, obviously the conditions are related to the earlier verses, but the later verses, I'm trying to appreciate the pure soul to actually the later verses.
As we recite the later verses, we're appreciating the great souls.
Yeah. So I use the later verses to appreciate the earlier.
Yeah. We should appreciate these sentiments and see the beauty of the process of bhakti. Sadhana bhakti, which is what we're all accustomed to, only has two stages. It's Vaidhi bhakti and Raghavita bhakti. Bhava bhakti has six stages. And Prema bhakti has eight stages. So the bellows of loving sentiment and the practice of devotion are much more prolific. In the higher stages, there's much more information or expressions in these higher stages. But because we don't practice them, we're not on that level, we just hear about the major symptoms which are mentioned. Nectar devotion mentions them. And Jaivadharma by Bhaktivinoda Thakur gives a more detailed understanding of these higher. We should read about them. But We should not try to imitate him, but we should understand the beauty of this process and how the soul's loving relationship with Krishna is expressed in so many ways. Krishna is unlimited, and love for Krishna is also unlimited. And it's unlimited in its quantity, and it's unlimited in its diversity too. There is so much diversification in love of God that it's very hard to understand. So Prabhupada gave us this knowledge, but he didn't want us to misunderstand it. Therefore, his Bhaktivedanta purports, where he explains how we should approach these higher teachings, is fundamental for our understanding, so we don't misunderstand. We have to read Prabhupada's explanations, and the explanations of the other channels also. They caution us, and they also guide us to understand these things. Everything has to be supported by Shastra. And that Shastra has to come from those who are on, who are in our line, such as Rupa Goswami, Raghunath Das Goswami, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, Chilajiva Goswami. These are the acharyas that teach us these higher levels. And they give explanations for the conditioned souls to help us understand. It's like looking through a lens. They're giving us the lens into the spiritual world, but without that lens, you can't understand anything. That lens is their explanations. So they don't just teach it, they also explain it. So along with hearing about them is reading the explanations of the acharyas. We must do that. Prabhupada said, if you're reading about Radha and Krishna, pastimes in Vrindavan, and you're feeling lusty desires, he says, stop reading. He says, these pastimes are meant to free us from these tendencies, but if the opposite has happened, he says, you're not qualified to read, stop. Because Rather than getting the nectar, you're getting poison from something that is meant to give nectar. So, you know, we have to approach these through the acharyas and through the guidance of our spiritual teachers. Our own spiritual teachers. Okay. I don't know if we have any more time. It's a little bit after 9. So they have to prepare for the kirtan program, and there is prasad. Thank you very much. Shri Shikshasthi Gavaki.
Shri
Prabhupada.
Shri
Prabhupada.
Shri Prabhupada.
Shri Prabhupada.